So Don, from a scientist's perspective, how do you put that in your model? I mean, this idea that the mind can actually have all these physical manifestations.
Well, I agree with Suzanne that we have found a lot of so-called top-down influences, that what you're building models in the case of visual perception, for example. You're not just simply taking a picture of what's out there. You're actually building models, and you're using the data that's coming in through your senses to refine your models. But in neural terms, the pathways that just feed forward the data from the eyes up to the brain are actually smaller than the top-down feedback pathways. They're even bigger. So there's a whole field of predictive coding where we're making these models, we're predicting what we should see, and then we're just checking against the little data that's coming in. And there's another level of this, though, and that is we do have clean evidence, except in some of the cases you're talking about, that there are clean correlations between neural activity and our conscious experiences. Although in some of these cases, you're showing that the neurobiology says one thing and the conscious mm-hmm. experience is something else. But there are all these correlations, and in the researchers in my field look at those correlations. We call them the neural correlates of consciousness. We're trying to look for the neural correlates of various kinds of conscious experiences. And there's lots of them, but the old adage, correlation doesn't apply causation, definitely applies here. You know, just because a bunch of people show up at a bus station and a bus shows up doesn't mean that the people caused the bus to show up there. It was something deeper, namely a bus schedule that caused both to show up there. And so when we have these correlations between brain activity and conscious experiences, we definitely have to, most of my colleagues think that the brain activity causes the conscious experiences. And the reason why I've been looking at this evolutionary stuff and showing that we haven't evolved to see reality as it is because it has an important implication. It means that the very predicates, the very language of space and time and physical objects is the wrong language to describe whatever the true cause and effect of reality might be. It's the wrong language. So we have in everyday life the fiction of causality. It seems like my right hand caused my left hand to move. And that's a useful fiction within our user interface. But it's just a fiction. Just like if you drag your icon to the trash can, you might say, well, the movement of the icon to the trash can caused the file to be deleted. And that's fine. That's a nice fiction for the user interface, but it's strictly speaking false. The icon moving on the desktop did nothing. There's no feedback from that into the computer. So we have all these correlations between neural activity and conscious experiences, and I've concluded the reason we can't figure out how brain activity causes conscious experience is because it doesn't.
Doesn't there have to be something that causes conscious experience?
Something deeper has to cause both our experience of the brain and the experience of the other conscious experiences that we have.
What's that something that's deeper?
Well, what I'm working on is an idea that consciousness itself, along the lines you were talking about, mm-hmm. that consciousness itself is fundamental. And to make that a scientific theory, I've had to develop, and I've published a couple papers with some colleagues, on a mathematically precise theory of consciousness. And it's mathematically precise not because I think I'm right. I'm probably wrong. But the point is to be absolutely precise so that we can figure out where we're wrong. And that's sort of the spirit of science, is absolute precision in what you're claiming so that you or others can figure out where you're wrong, and that's how you get things going.
So when you say your theory is mm-hmm. that consciousness is fundamental, in other words, right. it can't be reduced to something. It can't
that's
be
right.
reduced to,
right.
I suppose, the stuff of physics, right?
That's right.
You're
exactly.
saying it's outside the whole world of
right.
of matter, of particles. It's
that's
something
right.
else?
That's right. So it's every scientific theory makes certain assumptions. It says, please, if you're a physicalist, you might say, grant me space and time and, you know, neutrons and protons and electrons. And if you grant me that, then I'll explain chemistry and biology and even psychology and consciousness. And what I'm saying is, those are the wrong things to start with. Space, time, and physical stuff are the wrong starting point. Let's start with conscious experiences, like the taste of chocolate, the smell of garlic, and so forth. Start with consciousness. Have a mathematically precise theory of that, and then show from that foundation how space-time and physics comes out as a user interface that certain consciousnesses use as they interact with other consciousnesses. So it's a very different kind of approach.
And do many people agree with you on this?
Oh, very, very few.
No.
just my graduate students. Only my graduate students.